When I first started working with the terminal, I did the thing. I saw a senior developer post some nuanced take on Twitter about something I didn't understand, and I tweeted him asking how he got his terminal to look like that. He was kind enough to point me in the right direction, and now I frequently field the same questions from beginner devs. Text-based interactions can be confusing and intimidating. Not only is there a lot of terminology to learn, but it seems everyone just knows this stuff. Perhaps you felt dumb asking or just didn't have anybody to ask. In this video, we'll go over four key terms connected to the terminal. And if you stick around to the end, I'll even help you get started customizing your experience so you don't have to ask on Twitter. All right, first up is the term CLI, or Command Line Interface. This simply means interacting with your computer through text-based commands. So instead of clicking around menus or toggling switches, you enter text commands. Now, why would you want to do this? Well, let me suggest three good reasons. Additional insight, power, and speed. Text commands often return helpful info. Typing PS, for example, gives you info about all the active processes on your system. Or the TOP CLI command provides a real-time dynamic view of all processes, including CPU and memory usage. Text-based commands also provide incredible power. Not only can you run commands as an administrator when needed, but you can also do advanced searching and filtering of text files, transfer data to or from a server, securely and remotely access servers, and much more. Finally, once you learn key commands, the CLI is often much quicker than alternatives. As a simple example, you can create a directory and fill it with an index.html, index.css, and index.js file in two commands. So, what is the CLI? Well, it's a text-based way of interacting with a computer. Oftentimes, services provide CLIs, like Netlify, so that instead of clicking through menus online to add environmental variables, you can set secure variables with a text command. Now, where do you type this kind of text command? That's our second term, the terminal. To simplify things a bit, the terminal is the window, the GUI or the program, that provides an interface for typing commands, whether you're on your computer or on a server. Windows, macOS, and Linux distributions include default terminal applications, but many developers prefer more custom options. There are lots of options like iTerm, Windows Terminal, Hyper, Warp, Alacrity, and more. These applications often provide better performance, additional features like split panes or customizable themes, or cross-platform compatibility, so you have the same experience everywhere. Warp, for instance, includes autocomplete, mouse interaction, built-in workflows, AI features, and much more beyond standard terminals. Now, most terminals let you customize the look and feel of the application by choosing your fonts, text colors, and more. So, CLI means text commands, and the terminal is where you type those commands. But what interprets your commands? Well, that's our third term, the shell. The shell is the software that runs in your terminal. It takes your commands and then interprets and executes them. Most terminals can run a variety of shells. Some examples of popular shells are Bash, ZSH, and Fish. Now, Bash was the longtime default on macOS and Linux distributions, and it's still used for most servers. On both macOS and Linux, however, it's been replaced by ZSH as the default, which is generally compatible with Bash, but offers additional features like built-in tab autocomplete, syntax highlighting, and more. Basically, it's known for being more user-friendly. Fish, or Friendly Interactive Shell, has many of those same user-friendly advantages, but isn't always backwards compatible with Bash, which can make it difficult for some situations. On Windows, you have Command Prompt and PowerShell as two examples. And WSL, which stands for Windows Subsystem for Linux, essentially gives you a Unix environment in your Windows Terminal application, so you can run Unix shells like Bash or ZSH. So as you type text commands, the CLI, you type them into your terminal application, and your shell interprets and runs those commands. Now, which shell should you use? In short, it depends on your needs, but generally speaking, use whatever comes pre-installed on your system. One exception would be if you're a Windows user who's planning on interacting with Unix-based systems or commands. In that case, you should look into installing WSL so you can interact with those systems from your terminal application, as Windows is not Unix-based. Fourthly, let's circle back to the start. How do you get all those cool symbols in your terminal? Well, that's our fourth and final term, the prompt. It's provided by your shell and displayed in your terminal, and it's the input field where you type your text commands. While your terminal application can be customized, the input field where you type commands is controlled by your prompt. You can customize your prompt for your needs, setting its styling or contextual details, git info, and more. For example, my prompt shows my current working directory and git information. different shells offer different built-in prompts. Since macOS and Linux use ZSH, I'll use that as my example here. You can change the built-in prompt for ZSH by setting the PS1 value to a new value. For instance, to show your username, hostname, current working directory, and a hash symbol, type this. Not the most intuitive or pretty thing, huh? For that reason, most people who customize their prompts use third-party prompts, like Powerline, Starship, PowerLevel 10K, and Spaceship. They're all easy to install and customize. Alternatively, you can install full third-party frameworks that offer a variety of prompts, configuration options, aliases, and plugins. A very popular one for ZSH is OhMyZSH. These frameworks can help you not just customize your prompt, but also adjust the behavior of your shell. Now, once again, the most important thing is to pick a prompt or a framework that's compatible with the shell you're using. All right, so that's our four terms, but as promised, let's save you that tweet. Let me show you where I'd start for a basic setup to get my prompt looking like this. Now, I'll choose Warp as my terminal and use ZSH as my shell, since that's the default for macOS. Having chosen both of those, let's customize three things: my terminal theme, my terminal font, and my shell prompt. Like most terminal applications, Warp provides customization options for styling. Under Appearance, I can choose from a variety of themes. I'll choose one of the themes included with Warp. That's my theme setup. All right, next, depending on the prompt that you choose, you may need to install a different font. If I scroll down here, you'll see I'm using Meslo LGM Nerd font. Now, the important thing is that your font includes the ligatures and symbols that are needed for whatever prompt you choose. So generally speaking, whatever prompt you choose will tell you what font is needed for that. A lot of times these Nerd fonts will work for pretty much any prompt you want, and you can download it and install it like any other font in your system. All right, next, let's talk about that prompt. Warp actually includes its own native prompt by default. And here's a readout of all the supported prompts as of today. Now, from these options, let's choose the framework OhMyZSH. This will not only allow us to add more customization to ZSH, but also choose a custom theme. I'm gonna scroll down here. You can see it's pretty easy to install. I'm just gonna grab this curl command right here and copy it, and then I'll just paste it in down here. All right, so once that's finished, it creates a .zshrc file, which is a way of customizing ZSH, and then tells you you can add plugins or themes or other options. Now, what I'm gonna do is jump back over to the documentation and scroll down. Here you can see how to add in plugins for various services that you might wanna use. And then down below here, you'll see that it comes with a bunch of default themes that you can install. And this is the one it uses by default. It's added that to the .zshrc file by default. Now I can switch it out for one, and I'm gonna use this Agnoster theme. So if I come back over this way, I can open that file in a bunch of different ways, but I'm just gonna use Vim. All right, now if I scroll down to that line, in Vim you can delete things by hitting the D key twice, that'll delete that whole line. I'll then hit the O key to add an extra space, go up and paste that in. Now I can get out of this insert mode by hitting the escape key, and then colon W Q to quit and save the file. Then I'll hit return. All right, and now we've updated that. Now, in order to get this to show in Warp, I need to go ahead and restart Warp, so I'm gonna do that now. All right, so I've restarted Warp, but you may notice it's not showing my third-party prompt, and that's because, once again, Warp kind of helps you out of the box by giving you its own custom default. I can change it to my custom, though, if I want to, by clicking the prompt here and saying use my own prompt. And now you can see I'm getting this Agnoster theme directly from OhMyZSH. But today we've covered four important terms: CLI, terminal, shell, and prompt. And then just for fun, we've set up a custom third-party framework with a custom ZSH prompt in Warp called OhMyZSH. If anything wasn't clear or if you have additional questions, please drop a comment below. But I'll catch you next time. Thanks for watching. Happy coding.